left. South and Cedar 4th is Cromarty 4th. Veerable, mainly northerly, 3 or 4, becoming westerly or southwesterly, 5 or 6, occasionally 7 later in 40s. Fair than rain, good, occasionally moderate. German Bight Humber, northeasterly 5 to 7, occasionally gale 8 at first in southwest Humber, becoming veerable 4 later. Rain than fair, good, occasionally poor at first in Humber.
So there's a gale warning in Humber, which is, I guess, pretty much us, really.
Northeasterly 4, increasing 5 to 7, rain or shower.
Is being a bit rough. It's the tail end of a storm coming through here. The tide is still coming in, but I'm sure it's going to be a bit of a noisy night until the tide goes down and it'll go quiet. My plan is to take the duck punt along this creek here, snakes through the marshes. It emerges somewhere about here, and then I've got to get along this bit of coast here. Now there'll be a bit of a swell coming in, but if I wait until the tide goes down, then I've still got enough water to sail in. Worst comes to worst, I'll pick up this channel along here and then into Blakeney Harbour and down here into Blakeney itself. That's my plan.
Not the best of mornings, I have to say. However, punt is ready. Going to drift to start off with, just until I feel okay. Quite a nice southwesterly breeze blowing, which is good. Bit of a grey start to the drifting day. Symphony of greys, bluey greys. Well, there is some signs of life up there. Here's the first of these little bridges. I'm just getting about thrown into a corner here, but I'll let the channel take me, more or less. Such a high tide, there's a lot of crud flowing backwards and forwards along these creeks, so it gets dumped. It's all there. Basically, it's cleaning the salt marsh. The salt marsh will now, these spring tides, it's had all, it's like scarifying a lawn, it's all been cleared up and tidied up. My bow's about to bang and I'm about to flip round. Here we go. Bang. Thanks. So I put the sail up and the boat has gone from being a kind of inert lump, just moving at the behest of the water, to something that's alive. You're just moving along beautifully here. The water's high enough to give me clear air over the top of the salt marsh, so you can get some lovely little reaches. The wind's in the southwest today, so it should be in the right direction. I'm sneaking along this little creek here through the salt marsh. It's the back way to Blakeney. Locals would have known it well. There's a bridge across it now, so lots of boats can't use it. It's a shame. A dull old day. Sorry about that, lads. The window works a treat. But the light's not helping me any. You can see that it does work. No light. I put the pennant on the bow. You'd be amazed at how often the wind is in different directions on the bow to what it is up there. Put my favourite piece of tape from the old video player. Makes great telltales. I do love these bends. Look at this. It's going to make me work a bit now. Uh-oh. No, this has got to be the main one for me. Yeah, this is much bigger. Zephyr Award there. Here, look. At some stage, I should come to a bridge. Ah, talk of the devil. And there's a bird watcher. So, really opened up now. So, and I've been going against the tide for a while. Ooh, just a little bit of light for me, thanks God. Amazing how much wind shear there is between the bow and the top of the sail. You do want a twisty sail for this sort of thing, which is why the Optimist sail is so perfect. No idea how far it is to Blakeney. The North Norfolk coast. There's really nothing else quite like it in the UK. A strip of occasionally submerged land 30 miles long and just over a mile wide in some parts, much less in others. From Google Earth, it looks like a few mad swirls of colour from an artist's brush. My mind tends to read images into these landforms, just the way some people see animals in clouds. To my eye, Wells Bar at low tides looks like the head of an angry bird. Part gull, part raptor. But to spend time in this landscape without bothering to find out how it was formed requires the intellectual acuity of my Labrador. To understand the natural processes that created this place is, for me, as essential as knowing a bit about the history that shaped the lives of the people who live here today. And, of course, that human history has been shaped by the geography. All this beauty, symphony of form, texture, movement, has come about because along this stretch of coast, longshore drift has gone into reverse. Right down the length of England's east coast, the general movement of material, the shingle, sand, rock and mud, has been towards the south. The shape of the spits and bars tells you the way things are heading. But along this stretch of coast, the sea starts diligently moving material back the other way, towards the north and the west. This area is pretty well protected from the prevailing westerlies, but when a belter from the north or the east comes in, then stuff really gets moved around. A northeasterly gale can be a pretty frightening demonstration of the power of nature. This is the Wells Bar, it's a frightening mass of water. Oh man. Just disturbed all the way. You can see why you get those crazy shapes in the ground, in the sand. Just boiling. The bar at Wells is proof of the ability of the sea to shift stuff in incomprehensibly vast quantities. A bar is a heavy thing to move around, but the sea moves it as casually as you or I might stir a puddle with a toe.
hear the waves breaking on the other side of the bar. It's very hard for them to know where to put the buoys because it's moving around all the time. They'll put a buoy out and then there'll be a bit of a storm, or not even much of a storm. Just something less than a flat calm and the channel will move. It's just an amazing, amazing place. And then here you have this massive mud flat. Sand flats is what I'm wondering.
The other thing the sea does is to sort stuff out. Like a human with a compulsive disorder, the sea spends its time grading material into bits of similar sized particles. It'll store pebbles on beaches where everyone is more or less the same size. Sand it grades into 1,000 different categories before herding each tiny fragment into groups of like-sized grains.
Yes. Great patterns. You can see the way that the mud is landing in a different way and highlighting every little ripple in the sand.
This compulsion is reflected in the orderly yet free-form curves of Blakeney Spit, and in the ever-changing acres of sifted sand that is Wells Bar, and even to the mud channels behind the dunes and new islands. As the sea shifts and sorts, it's being driven by the immutable laws of fluid dynamics, beautiful, elegant, simple, yet infinitely complex. The moon-induced tide sends billions of gallons of water surging through these amazing landscapes. The power is incredible to watch and feel through the hull of a small boat. Going aground as the tide comes ripping in is an inspiring experience.
You can see the power of this tide. It's just amazing. It's moving around the bow and the stern of the boat and filling in behind and creating these whirlpools. Oh, there was a seal just playing in it just now. Incredible.
But the sea also takes its power from the weather systems that sweep our windy island. Through the winter and sometimes through the summer, powerful lows that come sweeping off the Atlantic stir the seas into action. The weather ashore is impressive, but where the sea meets the land, it can be truly frightening. This energy is used to change the face of the earth. Stand on the bar and you can watch the sea do its work. The big waves do the heavy lifting, shifting tons of material with each surge, while on calmer days, the wavelets and ripples laconically mess with the fine stuff. With the advancing and retreating of each tide, the wave line drifts backwards and forwards across the shores, acre after acre of carefully graded sand, which the sea and the physics sculpt into ever more wonderful landscapes between the high and low tides.
Then every now and again at low tide, a strong northerly will pick the finer sand up and hurl it towards the land. Here it forms into dunes that over time grow a few balding man's tufts of grasses. The mounds of sand grow into spits and occasional islands, which start to sprout trees and shrubs, while the sea spends its time backfilling with mud and microscopic particles. It sends them up every tiny micro creek and rill, each incoming tide bringing another contribution to the North Norfolk land building project. The books tell me that this process has been going on for 6,000 years. A mile of extra land in 6 millennia is pretty good going. Google Earth, which is easily the least evil thing that inhuman megacorp has ever done, helps me to unlock the miraculous geography of our planet. Here, across the new land, you can see the beautiful organic curves created by pure physics, along with the man-made scars that betray themselves with their slavish following of the straight lines. It's probably our greatest invention, the straight line, indispensable to the engineer, the lawyer, and the accountant. Seawalls have been used to annex and parcel out great chunks of land. But even out on the salt marshes, where land making is a slow, natural process, man has already moved in to exploit it. You can see the bridges and tracks that were used by the sheep and cattle that grazed out here. You can also see how many farmers tried to improve the marsh by cutting straight drains and shortcuts. For me, the reassuring thing is to see the way that the natural processes are always trying to reclaim their territory. Ultimately, the physics that shaped our planet will still be rolling on long after we humans have gone. Nature will win, which, generally speaking, I think is good news. This strip of sand, water and salt marsh is an essential feeding place for seabirds, both the migrants who just drop in here for a winter fuel stop to the residents that raise their families out here. To see them using this place, to hear their calls and to witness their complete mastery of the air is a gift beyond measure. Some people, though, come here not to look and listen, but to shoot and to kill. It seems utterly incomprehensible to me that anyone should want to do such a thing in this environmental treasure of a place. Even harder to understand is that they have a license from the government that allows them to do it. In this country, tradition is a powerful force, even when it makes no sense. But back to a confused old bloke sailing a 250-pound home-built boat through the salt marshes on an Easter Sunday when the East Anglian skies have decided that it's a good day for them to do a bit of glowering. The sailing is great though.
There's the waves out there.
Ha ha.
waves. I'm sure you can't see them on this camera. I must confess, I am a bit lost now. I'm on this headland, and you can see that there are waves over there, so I've got to wait for the tide to go down enough for the waves to disappear. The boat is here. Sea is pretty confused out there, so every now and again you get a big wave coming and some of them just cresting a little bit. Nothing to be worried about, but that's you. Don't really know what the boat will do. Slab-sided boats generally don't like waves cresting around them. Behind me is Stiffkey or Stookey. There is a head. We're just coming into Blakeney Harbour. I had to kill a bit of time because there were some waves, but you know they're always going to go. Those birds. Terrible camera to film you on, but. Thank you. pushing it a bit here, I think. Bottom move there. Okay, we made it. Wow, I felt the bottom flex up underneath me. That can't be good.
Blakeney Harbour is a work in progress. This massive block of water drains to a sandy expanse every low tide. I'll show you in another film. Blakeney is a free harbour. No fees, no harbour master. It's controlled, if that's the right word, by an ad hoc committee of locals. And it works. Sort of.
Again, you kind of... Well, that's a shovel. Okay. Every now and again you find something sticking out of the water. Not often a shovel, though.
Just one piece of advice to you guys. Build a duck punt. It's easy. I did it in a week, from first cut to first sail.